A storm was evidently gathering behind us. We had neither compass nor provisions, and it was clear that if we held our present course, we should be out of sight of land before daybreak. These thoughts, with a crowd of others equally fearful, flashed through my mind with a bewildering rapidity, and for some moments paralyzed me beyond the possibility of making any exertion. The boat was going through the water at a terrible rate, full before the wind, no reef in either jib or mainsail, running her bows completely under the foam.
Haven't I told you that what you mistake for madness is but a kind of oversensitivity? Now, it came to my ears, a low, dull, quick sound, such as a watch makes when inside a piece of cotton. I knew that sound well, too. It was the beating of the old man's heart. It increased my anger. But even yet I kept still. I hardly breathed. I held the lantern motionless. But the beating of the heart increased. It grew quicker, and louder every second. The old man's terror must have been extreme. The beating grew louder, I say, louder every moment.
Pass your hand, I said, over the wall. You cannot help feeling the nitre. Indeed, it is very damp. Once more, let me implore you to return. No? Then I must positively leave you. But I must first render you all the little attentions in my power. The amontillado, ejaculated my friend, not yet recovered from his astonishment. True, I replied, the amontillado. Then this ebony bird beguiling my sad fancy into smiling by the grave and stern decorum of the countenance it wore. Though thy crest be shorn and shaven, thou, I said, art sure no craven, ghastly grim and ancient raven wandering from the nightly shore. Tell me what thy lordly name is on the night's Plutonian shore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Next, a dozen stout arms were toiling at the wall. It fell bodily. The corpse, already greatly decayed and clotted with gore, stood erect before the eyes of the spectators. Upon its head, with red extended mouth and solitary eye of fire, sat the hideous beast whose craft had seduced me into murder, and whose informing voice had consigned me to the hangman. I had walled the monster up within the tomb. To be buried while alive is, beyond question, the most terrific of these extremes which has ever fallen to the lot of mere mortality. That it has frequently, very frequently, so fallen will scarcely be denied by those who think. The boundaries which divide life from death are at best shadowy and vague. Who shall say where the one ends and the other begins? Tis said that when the hands of men tamed this primeval wood, and hoary trees with groans of woe, like warriors by an unknown foe, were in their strength subdued, the virgin earth gave instant birth to springs that ne'er did flow, that in the sun did rivulets run, and all around rare flowers did blow. The wild rose pale perfumed the gale, and the queenly lily adown the dale, whom the sun and the dew and the winds did woo, with the gourd and the grape luxuriant grew. I awoke on the Lady Z. Her crew had seemingly abandoned her, and her controls were jammed in a slow turn to port. Was this to be my doom? Looking down, I saw we were circling above the island, which, from this angle, bore a mocking similarity to the face of the man who had brought me to this fate. Finally, move the cursor, click on the ship to complete your journey.